Hey guys, so I want this session to be more interactive. You can ask me any question, any doubt during the whole session we will be going through. And the structure of our session, the 3 hours would be, first 20-25 minutes I will be sharing more over an introduction to Angular 2. I guess a couple of you are already working on Angular 2, so would not need this. But for the benefit of everyone who has not heard of Angular 2 or has not worked on Angular before, I'll be introducing this. So then after the introduction of these 20 minutes, then we'll just hop on to a hands-on session. So for the very easy use case of CRUD, a basic CRUD application, and we all know that almost all applications, be it an enterprise app, be it a personal hobby project, or be it a commercial project, requires these basic operations. Like you want to show a list of objects, you want to edit a particular object out of them, or you want to create a new object using a form or something. And then, so we'll do a hands-on for one hour about how will we code an Angular app from scratch and build a CRUD application. Then post that we'll be I'll be talking about the migration, the major pain point of any developer today who is planning to learn Angular 2 or adopting Angular 2 is that most of you guys in the past 1 year would have shifted from some backend thing or some other to Angular 1. And now Angular team says that now Angular 1, the next version of Angular is not supported by or is not migratable. So how will we actually migrate our all Angular apps, Angular 1 apps to Angular 2? We just discuss some migration strategies around that. So then post my session, Vinci, the other speaker, Vinci Rousseff, will come and he'll be speaking about how you can take any Angular 2 application and create a progressive web app around that application. That will be also very interesting. So this is how our 3 hours will go. So just quickly wanted to discuss about how we have seen the web the evolution of web going forward, like from static HTML pages to dynamic PHP applications or dynamic CMS systems, where there was advent of Drupal, Joomla, WordPress, Magento. All of these things made it more like the web was now not of static information, but more of user curated content. So the web 2.0 world was more like the world web of the users, by the users, for the users, and stuff like that. Then came an era of, okay, now the dynamic content was there. Every user was blogging something, they were curating the content, creating dynamic websites. But now, those dynamic information was also becoming very monotonous. So the web needed some very engaging user experiences. Then came an era of rich internet applications. How many of you have heard of RIA apps? RIA, rich internet applications, they were called. And if anyone can name two important technologies that were, or any two or three technologies that were very important regarding this. Anyone can tell me that during the era of RIA apps, what you say, rich internet applications, which were the main technologies that were focusing on building rich internet applications?
Flash.
Flash, yeah. So it was back then Macromedia Flash, but now it is Adobe Flash. Any other technology? Any other?
Bootstrap.
Bootstrap was maybe, we can say later, but not
Silverlight.
Silverlight, yeah. So Macromedia Flash, Silverlight, Adobe Air, these all were applications where in the browser you could make very engaging user experiences, but there was a downside that you needed a plugin for them. There was a Flash plugin, there was an Adobe Air plugin. So those experiences were not native to the web. They were like a separate runtime or a separate plugin runs your code or any other in a sub third party language, like Macromedia Flash used ActionScript, or your Silverlight used C# and YAML, and Adobe used Adobe Air used something else. So right till then also the web was not the native, or the rich internet experience was not native to HTML or your web technologies per se. Then came the era of CSS3 animations, responsive design, and whatnot, which made possible for you to create rich, engaging experiences on the web itself using the native web technologies like HTML5, CSS3, JavaScript. So now you don't need all these plugin-based systems which were creating a havoc for users to install these systems to get access to these engaging experiences. And we all know that in the past 2 years, the experiences have been more performant and more engaging with the advent of best practices and new frameworks in the front-end world, which we all use as single-page apps, that we load an app once or we load a page once and then we just work upon the same UI or use the same user experience. Okay, so what are single page apps? Why do we want to use single page apps per se? So if you all analyze that 5-6 years earlier, if you used to open our computers or laptops, we probably went to program files or I don't even remember program. What was it called in Windows? All programs, or there was program manager, I guess, or something. So we used to find some. I meant that we used to use some native desktop apps to open some news reader or any kind of native app. But right now, if you open your laptops, what do you open first? I guess all could have directly opened Google Chrome, or Google Chrome would have been opened in your app. So now, web has become like the first class citizen of your user experience, or that has become the de facto for using any kind of software. So if I talk about software in terms of now, you would not talk to anyone regarding software, regarding the native app on a MacBook or on a Windows desktop app, but you will talk about web app. So web app have become the de facto software as per standards. So the single page app concept was more responsible because the single page app feels more like a native app of a desktop experience or a native OS experience, right? Am I right? So one app like user experience, then the single page applications enabled us some constructs in which we could have more robust client-side logic. So and again, then the next thing is all these single page apps should have proper navigation history so that you can represent a state of your view with a route, so that you can share the app state, or you can share that app's link with someone so that he can come to that particular state directly. So this is a very important paradigm of a single page app per se. Then your single page app should also support offline things. It should also have dynamic templates and data binding, that you could have a common template to show different kind of data. So for example, you are showing a user profile, you can use a sample template of a user profile and bind the data of any user and then display that data or that view onto your browser. Then there should be very nice animating or fluid transitions between different routes and views. And one other concept is nested views of single page apps. So your single page apps can be a bit complex with some main views and then having some nested reusable views along with them. I guess you might have used kind of some routing mechanism. So every single page app framework has either inbuilt or community supported router along with it, which can help you create these like routable views or nested views, right? So now the problem, how many have, just raise your hand, how many of you have used Angular 1? So I guess 70% of you have used Angular 1. So, and just if someone can tell me, what are the most or the biggest pain points of Angular 1 which you have faced in building some large scale application or some enterprise app?
Compile time errors.
Compile time errors.
Cannot identify the bugs.
Not compile time, I can say that, but the runtime debugging the exceptions that come. Anything else? So I know that this is a big problem. You always see that digest loop has occurred this many times, or you don't know why the digestive loop has occurred this many times or for what is the reason for causing it, and you get some nd get some URL on angularjs.org website that takes you to this, and that's a generic message for every exception, and you don't know what to do with that, right? That is the biggest pain point. Any other pain point? Guys, all of you have used Angular, and AngularJS at some point in time gets frustrating. You must come up with some pain points, or I would think that you don't need Angular 2 if you are so happy with Angular. So the biggest nightmare is that you can share your scope, any one scope, with any other person. You can share or you can call the root scope into any controller. So that was a nightmare that developers exploited. Developers, for their ease of development at that particular moment, devastated or frustrated the developer who will be working on that project 2 months down the line. I know, because I have worked on some projects which were developed by earlier developers, and it is a painstake to know that which scope or which event is affecting which view or something. That's such a big pain. What else?
Same problem with the process or something. There's some broadcast.
Yeah, so again, the problem is that Angular 1 gave the developer control of adding any watcher anywhere. So that means that Angular had to do the dirty checking of watching every watcher and then seeing that if some watcher again affects some other, so just reiterating that cycle till the application is stable. And that creates such a problem that if there one state is, or one scope is watching the variable of other scope and the same watcher is watching it back, it would create an indefinite loop and your application would get stuck. So again, one more thing is the life cycle of Angular 1 app is so complex that where does the route chain start, when your view come into the route, when your directives get initialized, and earlier there was no concept of components in per se, so it was very difficult. Then we have discussed scope inheritance was a problem. Then the painstaking digest cycle and dollar apply. We never knew when we had to apply dollar apply and when to not to do it. And if something would have, so I remember most of the developers, if we coded something and something was not displaying on the UI, we just did dollar scope dot apply and we thought that okay, now everything will display. That was a very bad practice without knowing using dollar apply anywhere. That was a very bad practice. But we as developers didn't know what to do. So what, I don't blame you guys, but blame the founders or blame the people who made that thing possible and gave it to the developers. We already discussed about excessive watchers. Then no inbuilt nested routing. So the nested router which we had to use in Angular 1 was a third party router only. And the ng if and ng repeat, not ng if, I would say ng if was better, but I guess ng show and ng repeat were the biggest culprits, right? So ng show we used like anything, and ng show means that so if you have an app and if you have like five different views of that app, and that you want and you want that only one view should be shown at one moment from that particular controller or page. If you apply ng show, all the five would have been into your DOM, and if your page was complex enough that your DOM was bloated up with thousands of elements every time. But ng if was better. And same with ng repeat. Ng repeat would blindly re-render every time any of your list items or any of your changes were deep. So one thing which we never tried to use, or as the initial application developers never thought of using, was track by. Track by was a simple performance optimization that anyone should have used from the beginning of your first Hello World application. But I guess there were not enough tutorials or demo apps where they were using track by out of the box. So everyone blindly followed that track by should not be used and we can use directly then. You all know that using track by simply enables you to not re-render your whole application, because Angular would track your ng repeat list by the unique key you bind it with a particular row. So having so much of pain. Okay, so you know that even more pain was there when the Angular team suggested that you can't migrate your app from Angular 1 to Angular 2, and Angular 2 was a rewrite of Angular 1. I guess the developer community sent so many hatred messages to the builders of Angular or to the Angular code team that, what are you guys doing? All the world, all the enterprise apps moved to Angular, and now you're saying that the next version of Angular won't be a direct path from Angular 1, and everyone had to do something else to do Angular 2. But it was for good. So Angular 2 team, when Angular 2 was in, okay. Just before I'm referring, I have to change my slides, but do you guys know that Angular 2 is now not Angular 2, but just Angular? So from now on, I'll try in my this presentation also, I refer it to Angular only. So now if you refer to the Angular 1 version, it can be called Angular JS, and if you refer to any version that is like after 2, that will be referred to as Angular only. Okay. So the whole purpose of re-architecting or redrawing the whole architecture from scratch, or rethinking the architecture from scratch, was that they wanted the performance to be the first class citizen or the main goal of your new architecture of this framework. Along with performance, there were other secondary goals like the developer best practices should be like inbuilt. There should be some conventions in which you should write your Angular 2 apps and such like that. And then another biggest goal was develop across all platforms. You know that these days this has become a paradigm that you write once and then run anywhere. That you should write a code once only, because the logic remains same across all platforms. Only some part of your rendering or your styling is different for each platform. So out of the box, Angular should support some constructs in which you can write a code once and then run it across all platforms like web, mobile, smartwatches, IoT, what all. Then I've already talked about speed and performance. Speed and performance, along with the basic core application architecture, they wanted to support universal rendering, use of service workers and web workers, using of data management libraries like Redux, RxJS and stuff like that. And then they wanted the developers to have an incredible tooling. The most biggest mistake of people who have switched from back-end development to front-end development feel that the absence of tooling in front-end is the biggest it is the biggest hindrance of those developers moving to the front-end apps. Am I right? All of you guys who have used Visual Studio or Eclipse or something, when you move towards front-end and are given Sublime Text without any plugins, you feel, what the heck I'm doing here? I can't even go to a particular file and see, search from the code, or inspect that particular code, or add a debug point in my editor or something. So one is that the Angular 2 team thought a lot about collaborating with multiple things and getting a better tooling for that. For that, they launched the incredible CLI things. They launched a Chrome dev extension called Augury, that is like your Chrome inspector. And then a lot of other things like static code analyzer tools and all. And the community support, now Angular 2 has been loved by millions, and it has been now supported by millions of developers worldwide who earlier shifted from Angular 1 to Angular to React or some other framework. Meanwhile, Angular was being developed. But after Angular 2 has been released and seen the performance of Angular 2, people are now adopting back Angular back. So what is the tech stack in which Angular is made? You know that JavaScript is at core of any framework per se. But now JavaScript, as we know, is not being used in all of our frameworks and all, and the current version of JavaScript is not even ES6, it's an old slide I have made. Now ES7, and now it will be called only ECMAScript, because ECMAScript has decided that it will be releasing the new features in a very short time span, approximately yearly, and all the next features that will be coming are called ES.next. And all the features that have been developed launched in 2015 are called ES6, and all the features that have been released in 2016 are called ES7. But we don't refer them now by ES6 or ES7. So again, this TS, can someone tell me what is TS? So, do you guys know that Angular 2, when it started, it was not using TypeScript? What was it using?
Dart.
So they had principles taking from Dart?
AT script.
Yeah. So the Google team internally for type checking and this were developing a ecosystem or a superset of JavaScript called AdScript, AT script. And parallelly, people at Microsoft have been using TypeScript to internally give typing to their JavaScript apps. So now everyone thought, the Google and Microsoft collaborated on this and thought that why we are reinventing the wheel and why we are doing the same things parallelly, we should collaborate so that our powers become more and the community can get a better thing. So TypeScript, they collaborated and said that Google said that we'll stop the development of AdScript, and whatever features we wanted to develop in AdScript, we should together form in TypeScript. And Microsoft also sold, okay, we'll open source TypeScript and everything the community can develop on TypeScript. So TypeScript was open sourced. Now TypeScript is at the core of Angular 2. Although it is not a necessity, you can write Angular 2 code without TypeScript also, but all the examples, all the samples online you would get will be with TypeScript, so I would suggest you use TypeScript. And literally, if I tell you what is TypeScript, TypeScript is nothing but to every variable you would define in your JavaScript or your ES6, if you give colon and the type of that particular variable, that what should be the type of a variable. The type of a variable can be of a primitive type like string, boolean, undefined, null, void, or it can be of a composite type like some class you have made or some interface you have made. So it is a normal, so TypeScript is just a superset of JavaScript bringing good parts of computer science principles like classes, interfaces and types to your JavaScript code. The rest, JavaScript is as it is and can be used. Any JavaScript which you write normally can be written in TypeScript. There is no difference. So people generally get scared that TypeScript, now we have to learn a new language. It's not new. It's same JavaScript, it's same ES6, just adding types to your variables or whatever you are passing, because it gives you a benefit of reducing your errors 50%, because your 50% errors can be like unconventional or unintentional mistakes that you make in your code. So at the compile time only, it will check that this type is being passed properly or not, and it will provide you compile time errors itself. The next is NPM. Everyone knows what is NPM. It's Node Package Manager. It's like we include jar files in Java and include DLL files in .NET. Similarly, in UI world, we include Node modules. And then we have some testing frameworks along with Angular 2, which is Jasmine and Mocha or Karma and some other tools. So there is one is the test runner, which runs your test, and the other is your scripting language in which you write your tests. So now, if you guys have followed Angular 2 from last 1 year, initially when Angular 2 was being developed, it was a very complex way of setting up a Angular 2 app. I guess most of you might know it was very difficult. You had to do system.import something or not. Now it is very easy. So we will not follow the old setup. The new setup, we'll be using Angular CLI today. Post this session, whatever workshop we'll be doing, we'll be using Angular CLI. So meanwhile, we are having this session. I guess most of you have Node.js installed in your system, right? So Angular CLI is very easy to use with simple commands. There are a lot of scaffolding providers in that. Some commands which will create some scaffolding templates for different constructs like components, services, and stuff like that. It will automate apps, e-commerce apps, which have like hundreds of products. And each of your dynamic products should be indexed by the search engine so that their results come on Google. So universal rendering supports that every dynamic route has its own SEO tags and is SEO optimized. The next thing is the Angular mobile and the progressive web app. So Angular thinks that this mobile support should be out of the box, because these days any Angular app or any web app per se is most of the time opened on mobile devices rather than being opened on your web devices. So any app should support proper responsive design as well as proper enriching user experience on mobile as well. So they have, like, you can create a mobile specific Angular project by giving a dash mobile argument to your command, as well as now they have released set of, this is an old URL, don't go by this material to app.git. Now Angular team has taken the Angular material into their own hands, and now you can access the material components of Angular using material.angular.io. So now just discussing a few about things about how Angular 2 speed achieves the speed and performances. Okay, one more interesting question I want to ask. How many of you used Angular 1, then when Angular 2 was not there for 1 year, thought about shifting to React.js or some other like Ember.js or some other? How many of you?
We shifted to React.
Okay, you shifted already. So most of the teams I've worked upon or I've interacted with, they thought that, okay, now Angular 2 was, we don't know Angular 2 when it will come, but everyone in the world, in the front end world, was intrigued by the virtual diffing concept of React. Everyone knew that the most expensive operation on your front end app is DOM manipulation. You can't do excessive DOM manipulation in your single page app to make, like, it will not be performant enough. And that virtual diffing algorithm, it was a simple algorithm, never thought of it, no one thought of it about that we should only do minimal DOM manipulations. So the same principle was thought about by the Angular 2 team as well. So there is a system called change detection, in which Angular also sort of does a very intelligent detection of whatever DOM changes need to be actually applied on your DOM, or whatever your component hierarchy change has occurred on. Okay. Then talking about code splitting, this is like your code, the user should be able to load only the code which is required for that particular view and not your whole bundle file. This has been supported by the bundling processes and all, and Angular 2 has optimized the default bundling process that has been coming in the Angular CLI. Then the code generation, CLI, server rendering, ahead of time compilation, these are all some features which Angular 2 team decided on to make Angular 2 more performant enough. And then using tree shaking, another important concept. I think these are very advanced topics. I'm just telling you how Angular 2 is faster than other. Today we'll mostly cover on the basics and how to make a simple CRUD application using Angular 2. So now, these days, the front-end libraries are more of a view framework. In your MVC pattern, it is more like just the rendering part of it. Along with the rendering part of it, you would need some extra library to manage your state of your application or the data flowing in your application. So generally, Angular 2 has good examples of supporting these all libraries like Firebase, Angular Fire, real-time databases, then Angular Meteor, Apollo. Apollo is a concept where Angular 2 can be integrated with GraphQL. Then you have support for RxJS out of the box in Angular 2. That RxJS is a reactive data management library which you can use. Then Angular 2 Redux. Redux is a very nice state management library which most of the React apps are using. So Angular 2 has integrations or support from community side, not from maybe the core team, but from community side, integrating to all of these libraries. Then the problem was Angular 2 cross-platform. Ionic, how many of you have worked on Ionic? Okay, a couple of you. So now we also need that the same web application we run should be running on different mobile devices or different platforms per se. So Angular 2 had this in mind that we should support this cross-platform things out of the box. So they had some principles in mind, and they decided with the largest frameworks in the community. So the largest framework in the Angular community for hybrid apps was Ionic. So they collaborated a lot with Ionic team so that the Ionic 2 version should much incline with the Angular 2 principles, and the Ionic 2 should be very performant enough for hybrid apps. So Ionic 2 is a platform where you can use. Some people have even tried React Native with Angular 2. So that I don't know how they have tried, but they have tried. Another important thing is native script for Angular 2. So native script is a framework in which you can write an Angular 2 app. The same Angular 2 app will have a mapping, one-to-one mapping with the native components. So ultimately on your mobile devices, the native components of that device or that OS, like in iOS you have iOS native components, and in Android you have native Android SDK components or Java view components. So whatever you write in Angular will be mapped to the view components in that specific OS language. And the other part of it, leaving the mobile part, we also want to run our web apps as native apps on desktops, as a Windows exe file or as a Mac file or as a Linux file. So Electron is a framework that would support out of the box. And Angular 2 has a lot of examples along creating a universal Windows apps or creating a Electron app. Just 2 lines. Okay. So now discussing about what is the core structure or the core architecture of Angular 2 app. Okay. So the major change from Angular 1 or change from a generic UI framework to Angular 2 is thinking about our web apps as not a set of pages but a hierarchy of components. So our whole application, we should not now think as a set of pages or a set of some views that change randomly, but we should think that our whole application is a root application when we have some different bunch of views or states in them, and that state or that state should be bind up with a particular component that should drill down in a proper hierarchical manner, in a hierarchical structure. So in Angular 2, we think of our application, our root application, as an app component. Like our whole application is a component in itself that we call it, we can call it anything. I'm just saying an example, you can call it an app component. If it is a CRUD app component, if it is an e-commerce app component. So your whole application can be a root component. And then probably in the most practical scenarios, after your root component, there is always a router component. So your root component or your module will have, before the router, you may have a layout for the component for your app. That your app, only there are some fixed parts of your app, like your header, your footer or something. So your app will have a layout component where you would have a master kind of a scenario. If your complete app doesn't have a master, you can have a nested component which will have it routed itself. So by nesting these components, even you can nest routes as well. So you don't need nested router per se from Angular 1. So your whole Angular app should be components. So component is at the helm of affairs. Any component. So now we'll talk about the structure of how one component interacts with all other constructs of Angular 2. So there is one component, and then to render a component, their component is nothing but an ES6 class, or you can say a plain JavaScript function. It is an object in JavaScript. That object in JavaScript will define the behavior of your component. So the behavior of a component is generally some initialization data massaging which you do, or some event handling, like in your component, if there are some browser events or if some there are some user interaction events, how will you handle it? Or if you want to make some request to the server to get some data and then display some data, right? Anything else? Okay. So now, after you define this behavior in a component in a function, you want to render the actual structure on your browser. That is done via a template which contains your HTML code or your markup code, which will display elements or display the visual things on your browser, right? So earlier, we want that whatever behavior, if we have some data changes, but how Angular 1 achieved it was bad. So that's why we should not like implement that kind of pattern, and Angular 2 decided that we'll leave off that digest cycle pattern. So how Angular 2 does is, we'll see how, just starting. So just taking 1-2 minutes. So in Angular 1, what they do is, anyone could attach a watcher to a particular JavaScript object, and the DOM will get updated regarding that watcher. And the same thing, that your JavaScript object was watching the input elements in the DOM, whatever DOM changes were done, it updated accordingly. And this was creating a cycle. And in Angular 1, it was not hierarchical in nature. So this watcher, anyone could add a watcher to anything or anyone else. So that created a problem of maintaining this whole list of watchers and then reiterating these watchers every time one single change happened in your own app. So now in Angular 2, any questions till now? Any doubts? Okay. Now come. So now, how Angular 2 achieves this data binding? Okay. So now, after this two-way data binding went bad in Angular and stuff like that, all other frameworks thought that we'll never try to achieve this two-way data binding directly, or we'll not say it two-way data binding. So there was a concept, an important concept in UI frameworks used is this, that we should have a unidirectional flow, that our data should always flow from top to bottom and nothing else, because we should maintain that the source of data should be at one place, and whatever data changes are doing at that place, it should always propagate all the changes to the to its children at the, and it will reach the leaf node, but the data will always from top to bottom. So now we have decided that our application will be a hierarchy of components. In that hierarchy, if you want to pass a data, we can only pass from top to bottom. So generally, top to bottom also would mean that from a component to template, to your view, actual DOM node or your browser, you will always pass the data from your component to your view. Your view should not pass the data or change the data of your component back. So what happens is that there is a way called property binding. So these are normal properties. So any component, if it defines some data property, it will bind to the template in a one unidirectional manner, and the template will get updated whenever the property changes into the component. Anything changed to the property in your template will not update your initial component. Okay? How? But then now, how will we achieve two-way data binding if it doesn't update? So the unidirectional data flow says that the data flow will be done in one direction, and if there are any changes to your data, you should propagate an event, probably an action or an event. Action is called in Redux, and you can say in normal terms it should be an event that the UI or the browser should tell the system that I want some changes to the data. Or any kind of message that it wants, this event should happen. Whatever the event processing will do to the data, will change some data, and then again the new data will be propagated back to your component in a unidirectional flow. So there can be a proper route. So it's like you see that in generally in India, traffic jams are caused because anyone can go from any side, because there is not a proper direction people follow in. That's what happened probably in Angular 1, I guess. So, if you want to update anything from your template to your component, you bind an event to your component. So your template can initiate an event. An event can be a browser event, an interaction event, or some custom events as well. And there is something called metadata in Angular 2. I'll tell you more about it. Metadata is nothing but annotating or decorating your component with some initialization or meta properties that your component should behave in this way. It should extend from this type of component. It should inject these kind of services or these kind of dependencies it have. These are the meta properties that we'll be defining over our Angular 2 components, right?
Dependencies, do they come in constructor?
So that we'll see in the code. Dependencies come in the constructor, but your decorator has to know what it has to inject into the constructor.
In Angular 1, we have a controller. So is it replacing?
So we don't have controller anymore in Angular 2. So controllers are a thing of past, because controllers could be appended to any dot node, because there was no construct of proper component and proper hierarchy. So in one particular view, in a particular route page, you can have like 10 DOM nodes. Inside the 10 DOM nodes, only 2 DOM nodes were added a controller. So the whole component didn't know that what are the subcomponents inside that particular component. So controllers are replaced by components, mostly directives also. Then after we do this data binding, similarly, apart from component, we all know this rule that if we have to do any kind of DOM manipulation in Angular, we have to create a directive. Yes? Everyone had this principle in mind that if you want to do any DOM manipulation, use a directive. So the same thing is there in Angular 2, but in a more constructive manner, in a more standardized manner. There are two types of directives in Angular 2. One is called attribute directives and one is called structural directives. So structural directives are used whenever we want to add a node to the DOM, remove a node to the DOM, or modify the DOM. So any DOM changes require us to create structural directives. But there are some directives where we only change the behavior of that same DOM node and don't change, like add a click event listener or change some CSS properties and nothing else. Those are called attribute directives. Okay? Then coming back to services. So what were services in Angular 1? They were nothing but a construct where you define set of functions and expose that function, someone would use that function. So it is just a piece of reusable code which you could use in multiple places, right? In Angular 2 also, it is the same. Services are nothing but your plain TypeScript classes or ES6 classes where you could write some methods and some properties, and then some component can reuse those properties or use that logic. Okay. And then all of this, so you can add your component to a namespace kind of thing which is called an Angular module. So Angular always believed that to organize a large application or a large structure, you have to make modules of your whole application. So you could add a set of services or a component or a directive to a particular module construct and any other import it into any other app or any other module. That is it. So any questions on the architecture part? Any doubts? All clear?
We don't always in the hierarchy, right? Because the components are always in the hierarchy.
Yeah.
So, but to look at it in the real time, I can have two different components which are totally independent and they can be replaced by another. So, how is that?
So you're saying you can have two different components and then
they can be independent, right? So
they can be, but your root components. So you always, you always have to have an app component that will be at the root of component. So now the children can be different, n number of children of that root component, but it will maintain a hierarchy. So Angular would know that there is a root component which you have to define or give it while bootstrapping your Angular app, and then all the your rest of the components will be the project structure setup. A big problem with Angular 1 was also that to find the best starter template, or how would you start a new project, what will be the scaffolding, what will, should be the project structure and all. This gives you a basic structure. Guys, is it visible? So, the files automatically created inside our project will be, there will be two folders, E2E and SRC, and it will have all these files like .editor.config.getignore, angular.cli.json, karma.conf. So it will set up some meta properties regarding the CLI, regarding the test runner state, and also the bundler. So if we go to the source file, we'll see that we have another three folders called app, assets and environments. And then we have our main files, which is main.ts, and inside the app there will be app.ts. So if we go to our main.ts, so this is the place where your bootstrap happens for your app. So what happens is that we'll see that your main app will have a module. So we we'll see that first. So in order to create your whole app, you will have to have the basic core modules that Angular 2 provides to create your app structure. So the basic module is like Angular core for sure. So you require ng module from Angular core to define your module. So ng module, like it has written, add the name ng module and then a bunch of properties or a bunch of object that defines a lot of property. So does someone know what is this add means? Or writing at the rate ng module. Someone should have asked the question till now. It's a decorator. Does someone know what is a decorator?
Meta properties.
So meta properties. But so what happened is that most of you who must have coded something in Java or .NET, there is something called annotations in some backend languages that you annotate a particular function or a particular property to define some extra behavior regarding that. Similarly, there is a JavaScript spec or TypeScript, it was there. Do you all know Yehuda Katz? Yehuda Katz was the creator of Ember.js. He initiated a spec around decorators to be included in JavaScript or in ECMAScript inherently. So this decorator is a stage 3 spec which is there in your ECMAScript specification, which will be coming to browsers soon also. So decorator is nothing but you can annotate a particular class. This is a class, a JavaScript class. You can annotate a class, you can annotate a function, or you can annotate a property. So annotate or decorate means that you are defining some extra layer on top of that particular function, on top of that class, or on top of that property to change the behavior of that particular property. So ultimately for you, Angular 2 uses this concept of decorator. This is an advanced concept. We need not to go into the detail of what decorators does is, but just know in Angular 2 we'll see a lot of things that we will define some meta properties for some class, some function or some property using decorators, using these add properties. So generally the decorators are nothing but functions like add ng module. We are invoking that function and then we are passing an object. That object contains some key value pairs, right? So a decorator is nothing but another function that is used to change the behavior of the function which is written just next to that decorator, and that decorator takes in input some kind of properties, meta properties to change or to drive that behavior. So here in our ng module, so ng module is the core of Angular 2. Everything in our Angular 2 will be inside a particular module. Generally for a small application which we'll be coding today, we'll be having only one module that will be called our app module. So this file is called app.module.ts, which contains the definition of our app module and what all things are required by this app module. There are four important properties of this decorator or the configurations we can pass in this decorator, which are called declarations. Declarations mean that any component that will be used inside this particular module. So generally in declarations we pass only view based components or anything that will be affecting the view. In Angular 2, two things will be affecting the view. One is your components and the other thing is pipes. Pipes is nothing but your filters in Angular 1. Those are called pipes in Angular 2. So any pipe or any component you make and you are using anywhere in your this module, you have to remember to keep them in the declarations part or pass them in the declarations part of it. Then there is imports. So imports means any other module this module is dependent on and wants to import will be imported here. So any other ng module if you are using in this module needs to go inside imports. Then providers. Providers are nothing but like it represents your dependency injection. Any services you want to inject into your module, you use a provider to inject that particular service. So if you remember in Angular 1 also, any value, any constant, any service or any factory was ultimately a provider, and those all were called syntactic sugars on top of a provider. Has anyone used a provider in Angular 1?
Couple of them.
So providers is nothing but an array of all the services that will be used in this. Then the last part is bootstrap. Bootstrap means that this particular application or this particular module will be bootstrapped using these components. So you can pass an array of components. Then coming to main.ts. So now in the main.ts, we include the basic modules by Angular, like platform, browser dynamic. This is some internal browser usage module. Then we enable prod mode to enable the prod mode. There is something called environments. This is just to give you the best practices of the code principles. Angular 2 has scaffolded this project to provide this space, because we all know that in our enterprise apps or in proper apps that we use in our day-to-day lives, we have different environments like a staging environment, production environment or a pre-prod environment. So they give you to define some configurations for each environment into this environments folder. If you see here, we have environments folder. Environments folder has two things called environment.prod.ts and environment.ts. This is nothing but a configuration object which will define your configurable properties of a particular environment. That's it. It's just a place where you can define different properties and you can access that in your app using environment.something. And what it does is, whenever you run in a particular mode, it will copy that particular file. Like this file is environment.prod.ts. If you say enable prod mode, it will just copy this environment.prod.ts into environment.ts file. That's it. Now coming back, now in order to bootstrap our module, we use the platform browser dynamic function to call the method .bootstrap module and pass it the module which we want at the root of our whole app. So any particular app will have a module at the root, and that module will bootstrap internally with some component. So now if we say that in our app module, we had said that this app module should get bootstrapped with our app component. So now we'll see what our app component is. So our component is nothing, it is importing the main component class or the component decorator from Angular core, and then just doing add component, which is a decorator taking input some meta properties like selector. What is selector? Selector is nothing but the name of the HTML element which you will be using in your HTML templates. So you will say angle brackets app dash root and then closing angle brackets app.go. Then whatever template we want to bind with this component, we'll use template URL, or you can use a template string as well using template. The same is the third is style URLs. If you want to attach some CSS properties to the style of Angular 2, you can pass in the CSS relative. So always these paths have to be relative path to this particular component structure or component place in the folder structure. Then you can pass some properties. So you define a class of your component. That class can have two things. One is any properties, and the second is methods. You can have different methods that will be attached to some event on the view. Okay. Now, in order to run this run the app, if someone has used Angular 2 6-7 months before, I guess two people have talked to me, you have to use the system import, and then you have to do that you have to import the definitions of that TypeScript and something like that. That is now not needed. Now you just do ng-serve, and I have to do cd, go into that directory. Takes a small amount of time because it is compiling all the TypeScript initially to your JavaScript code. Finally, it creates a bundle. See, our bundle is so less because we don't have a code in it, but the vendor bundle is 2.83. We can reduce this vendor bundle size by gzipping our bundle when we release it in prod mode. So if I go to localhost 4200, I'll be able to see my basic app, that Hello World app that is there, which just renders a string in our app component. Any questions in this? So what happens is that our main.ts is the entry point for our app. This is the place where, which is like the first most JavaScript, which will be in our bundle.js. This will be at the top after the vendor code, and then after this code, our app module will be called. Our app module will bootstrap a particular component, and that component will be displayed. Okay. One more thing, how does actually it our app comes on the HTML? In your, so if my web app is serving our bundles JS files, those bundle JS files are injected into this HTML by the dev server, and ultimately we are including that HTML template app-root, which we had as selector of our app. So this is where the initial bootstrap happens, that whenever the Angular parses the root of your template and then sees this particular app-root, and it will initialize all the construct of your app and place it inside this component of your HTML page. Okay. So now let's go to the next step. Now we'll do some basic type checking. So we'll see how we can check our types in our this component and stuff like that. Okay. So we'll just update this code. So as I told you that we had less time, so if you don't follow it right now, you can go to this link and copy exact steps, and you'll be able to achieve whatever we are achieving this. We have to go into the app component.ts file and we'll copy this. So what I am doing is, I have created a new some new properties in my app component, like title and session. And I told you, TypeScript is nothing but plain JavaScript along with colon and then type of your element. So title is a property we are defining on the class. Colon, we are saying that it should be of type string. And then session info, I want some other property, and then colon session. So this session, we know that it is not a primitive like a string, a value, a boolean or something. It has to be some type defined. So if we go below, we see that we have defined a simple interface that is a composite object, and that composite object defines the type of that particular. So I have defined an interface session. Interface is nothing but, we all know in computer science principle, interface is nothing but just a definition of a particular class. So we have to define whatever properties and methods should be implemented by a particular class or a object. So we define that it should have a topic as string, speaker as string, and duration in minutes as numbers. Then in the constructor of our app, we are just initializing all of our things with some data to pass in to get displayed. The next part would be we have to update our template in order to show these things. So I mean, another thing is that now see, I don't have to do refresh or anything, because another thing inbuilt into the Angular CLI is your hot module replacement, which automatically replaces whatever bundle is getting updated. Whatever code you update, it gets compiled on the go and it gets updated, and the browser gets notified that there is some update and it gets refreshed automatically. So nothing you have to do yourself. So we see that all our data has been displayed, session feedback manager, topic, the dynamic which we added. If we just see the template, how it does. So the normal binding syntax is similar to Angular 1. You use double curly brackets to get any property from your component into your template. So this will be only one-way data binding. This will not have two-way data binding. It will be only the property which you define in your component which will get binded to the particular place in your template and get it rendered. That's it.
User expressions.
These are
expressions binding.
Yeah, this is expressions, like only one-way expression. Now these are not angular expressions like two-way expression, normal angular expressions.
We'll have a data type as
no, so data type I showed you, the data type is in your component, in your not in your view. In your view ultimately it is a property that is been bind to, but the type checking is always in the JavaScript part of it.
But JavaScript don't have any type to.
Yeah, so what happens is that you are writing this TypeScript, I am having title string. So what happens is that if I pass this 90, I have passed the 90 should be number. If I pass it as string, it will give me an error. In this my, if you see in your command prompt, it will say that the type of property duration in minutes are incompatible, string is not assignable to type. So this is the type checking is at the compile time and not the runtime. So it will be present in your JavaScript code and not in your HTML code. Okay. So one thing I am just including from my previous example, I had used some CSS to style our view. I'm just trying to include that here. I'll update the online link with this CSS file. I haven't updated till now. Yeah. So just to show some nicely whatever we are seeing. So this is nothing, now we have created a simple module, we have this some data, the first data topic was a normal string, the title was a normal string, and then the session information is a object that we bind. Okay, any questions still here?
Why do we use constructor? I'm not very much aware about OOPS concept.
Okay, so then you have to go and research some OOPS concept. The constructor is anything you want to initialize into that particular class uses constructor. So constructor is, you can think of an entry point or initialization at the time of initialization. If you want to do anything, you put that in constructor. So I could do the same thing here also. Rather than doing in the constructor, I can pass it here. If it is was a static property, it would work. It updated automatically, it worked. You didn't know, okay. Yeah, so it got updated.
So inside constructor.
So why do we use inside constructor? Because if you don't want static data, if you want some data from a service or an AJAX request, so any code, any behavioral code you want to write in the initialization, you have to write in the constructor to call that service and then fetch some data. Outside the constructor, you can only initialize static data. So these all initialization to a property inside a class can be static or some dynamic based on some const variables that are defined in this scope only. But you can't do some behavioral or JavaScript code if else or some conditional code you can't write outside your constructor.
Now these constructor having different scope, the context of this.
Yeah. So constructor have a scope of this particular component only.
Why do we use this dot session module?
So constructor any time your object gets initialized, it has its own scope. Every function has its own scope. In JavaScript, if you use inside a function, you have to use this to access the scope of this. This is a very basic JavaScript concept.
That is basic, but title you have initialized outside the constructor, which means title should be scope of title should be inside the constructor without using it.
You have to see. So constructor is for this component. This whole class has the scope of this. Anything we write inside the class will be having this scope. Constructor is just to initialize or bind some properties on this. So ultimately the constructor function, when this class will get converted into JavaScript, it will be app component constructor. The name of that function will be
app. Ultimately app component is a function, right?
Yes.
And constructor is inside that function.
Yeah, so internally it implements that, it calls the constructor function at the top whenever that it gets initialized. Okay. So quickly moving towards the next thing. Now we'll do a new component. We'll try to create a new component and see how easy it is to create a new component. We'll create a new directory inside our app source as make components. So I am just making a new directory. So but wherever you want to create a new component, you have to go to that directory and using an Angular CLI command called ng space g, and then writing whatever type of component you want to make and that the name you want to give to that particular component or constructor. So when I say ng-g component feedback, if you see, it has created all the necessary things for me inside my component folder. There is a feedback folder. Feedback contains four necessary files. One is your feedback.component.css file, your template file, your spec.ts. Spec.ts is nothing but initial testing unit tests for that component. And then there is feedback.component.ts, that is the actual class of your component. Okay. So now what we'll do is we'll write a basic component. I'll copy this. So right now if we see that the basic component which it has created, it has nothing but only an empty constructor and an empty ng on it. So I'll tell you something about onInit, why it is onInit. So this onInit, it imports from the Angular core. This is just to explain that you should add the lifecycle method of ng on init to this particular component. So whenever we implement this particular interface, so this is not anything but interface which ensures that your component should have an ng on init method. If I remove this and I can, so if you just see quickly, just for the sake of showing, if I remove this and save this, it will give me an error that I should have defined the ng init because I implement this interface. So whenever we implement an interface, we have to define all the properties and methods of that interface.
Implements is nothing but inheritance.
Extends is inheritance. Implements is that it ensures that whatever interface you are implementing, you should have all the properties and methods of that particular interface.
But it's not mandatory to inherit.
It's just by default it does. Okay, so now I have created this basic new feedback component. I'll explain what I have. I have defined a private, so there is access specifiers also which you can use along with defining properties. So you can define the access specifier and then define what property type it is. This is the name of the property and this is the type. So I should have an interface for feedback info which I have at the bottom. And I have a feedback info interface which gives name, company, email, mobile, speaker rating, trainer rating, some stuff. Okay? Now,
private is nothing but access specifier.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
So what we have, internal protected, all is there?
I guess it is private, public and not protected and anything, only private and public. Because whatever specifiers or whatever types you could define into your normal JavaScript function. So inside a normal JavaScript function, if we define anything on the this keyword, it becomes public, and whatever we defined as var in a local function scope, it becomes private. So this is following the same construct. So now, now the other important thing is, now if our component wants to take some input from some outside parent component, how would it take? So there is a property called, there is a input decorator which you have to include from your Angular code, and the input property can be written at input. This decorator right now doesn't need anything, so it doesn't take anything. You can see input binding property name. If you want to give an alias to this property, you can pass in an alias name inside that input. We'll see it later. Okay. Now into the normal input tags, you can also define as getter and setter methods. So after you define an at input, you can write set or you can even write getter. So inside set, I am saying that it will take input as of info object as of type feedback info. Feedback info is nothing but that interface which I have shown you, right? And then I will initialize my another standard info object. Why I am doing this is because I am defining a null check for all these feedback info. If any property wouldn't be there, I will assigning my info property which I am getting from here on top of this, so that if any of these fields is not there in the input element, it will be overwritten by the default fields.
No.
This is just a string which I am providing to show. Do you all know what object.assign does? Object.assign will override only the properties which are there in defined in this over to this. So if there is any null property, it will only take the take this property back. Okay. Now we'll also update the template of this particular element. So my template is nothing but now the variable which I defined was underscore data, the property which I defined on my component. So whatever I need to display, I need to use this underscore data into my component.
Can you just show where the underscore data?
Yeah. So this I renamed as underscore data, and I pass this into when the setter of this property, whenever this particular component will get input from a parent, it will invoke this setter function. It will do this logic and assign that whatever input it has got into my this underscore dot data. Now I have to update my app component to have a static object to pass this data to something. So I just don't update everything because this code is only for the app component. So I have updated my app component with new property session info session. It was there. I said feedback. One important thing I wanted to tell here is, if you do not know the type of any particular variable, you can say colon any. Any is a type that can take any kind of object. If you don't know the exact type, because sometimes you are integrated through some third party APIs and you do not know that what type of object they will give, you can use $any. Don't use it for everything because it is there. Just use it when you really do not know what input you are getting. Now I have just informed, just initialized some static data on this. Now what we have to do is, inside our main app component, we have to render this particular component. Okay, in order to render, so if you see our feedback component, we have given selector feedback. If I write feedback there, it will render. So if I go to my app component.html, okay, but now what important part is that I need to input this with the info, that property which I had. So as I told you, in order to input any property to a particular component, we always use square brackets inside the property name, and we have to pass something from the scope of this particular component. So if you go to our app component, we see that I have defined this feedback as a property that will contain all the information regarding this feedback. So I will pass this feedback property into my info property of my feedback element. So I will say just the name into the string, nothing else. You don't have to use the expression, the curly braces here. You have to use equal to and the name of the current component's property which you want to pass to this component as an input element property like this. Clear? Now we'll see if any no error came in my. So now all that information is being displayed, like name, that dynamic one, that I'll change the name so that we can see if something gets changed. From our, so now our app component, the root component, is passing the data back to a child component, that is the feedback component. So we see that this has got updated. So ultimately my data is flowing from my parent component to my child component to display. I'll just add the CSS for this. I just made this tutorial like 1 week back, so just forgive me, I'll add the CSS to that online things. You can give them your own styling. So this is how I'm just showing the data here, in name, company, email, mobile, speaker rating and all. Okay?
So are we keeping this
style component, or? So generally it is better to keep it component by component. So I am keeping it in component. So this I have pasted in my feedback component.
Suppose we need to
reuse that component. So then you could use something called SASS or CSS, where you could create mixins of reusers. So CSS is a separate, writing modular CSS in itself is a separate task. So I'll update the my feedback, my app component. So I was giving a class to it to use it later. Okay, now we have done this. Now let us create a list of these feedbacks. So now we have displayed a normal so we have created a child component, and we have shown a particular for example date. We have passed that data and shown that data, right? Now we want to generally create a list of elements and show that data somewhere. So we'll create another component called feedback list to display this. So what you will do, inside your components folder, again run this ng component feedback list. It will automatically create all the necessary files. I guess this is a feature which I miss in React, which I also develop in React. So if I have to create a component in React, I have to create the JS file, the CSS file and the index.js to export it. Okay, so now we see that the feedback list component has been generated like that only. So now, generally I want we want that all our definitions for these interfaces or our types, we should keep it in a separate file. We should not keep it everywhere. It is dependent on you. Generally, I prefer that if we keep it separately, it will be better. So you can create a new folder called interfaces inside your app and move any kind of interfaces there. So I can create inside my app a new folder called interfaces. And inside my interfaces, I can create a new file called feedback.ts and put this there. So what I've done is just I've included the feedback interface there. You probably have to export. Okay. So now the next step would be to make my list element to show a particular list or initialize that with some list. So just update the feedback list component with this. So just the class. Don't update copy paste whole like I'm doing. Only the class part where I've written only the class, just update only the class. And we have to also, here it is saying input is because it was giving a red line. Okay. Now it is also saying that feedback info. So I'm defining a feedback list component and then I'm defining some property like which row I want to show out of the list. Maybe at later stage I want to create a list where I want to expand a particular option. So for that expanding, I'm just writing a flag or a property that which row index number I want to expand to. Then I am want to input a data. So we in the last component we saw if you want to take any input as property, we have to use any input. So here I have defined a string. This string will just create an alias of the property that has come from outside, and this property will be expecting on our component. We'll see. And then type of this would be the interface and array. So this property will expect an array of these interfaces or an array of objects of feedback info type. Now I have to import that feedback info type also. So I have defined that in now the error which was coming here has gone because it has got the feedback info type. Now I have another method. I just wanted to show that apart from the constructor where you want initializing your some properties, why do we have to use ng on init when we have the constructor, right? What is the difference between ng on init and constructor? Inside the constructor, any input element we are getting from parent will not be accessible here, because this is the constructor which is creating the JavaScript instance of it, and Angular has not yet binded its own bindings on top of it. So inside your constructor, if you will try to do this.list, it will fail. But if you do it inside your ng on init, it will work. So for example, if I do it here, it will give me an error later. Okay. So now the next step is we will modify the template of a list to show the list of elements in a table like structure. So what I have done is I have a header feedback list, then a pure table. This is just a class given, then a table showing the headers of that particular table. And now a body. So now we see what is this ng for. So what is the alternative for ng repeat? Now wherever you want to list a particular, you want to render a list of items, earlier you were using ng repeat. But now Angular team thought that we should have a syntax more familiar with the basic native constructs. So the JavaScript now has a for loop called for of loop. where you could write a temporary variable that will hold the iterator of that particular row, and you can write off and the list item, the array which you are iterating. So this is a temporary variable which will always point to the current iterator out of this particular array 1, and it will iterate. It is more like for each loop you must have written. Now for off is in native support of all the browsers. You can use for off loop in JavaScript directly also. And along with that, I want to also initialize automatically whenever you run this ng for, there is an index property similar to ng repeat. And I will pass this index property to another temporary variable called leti. All of you must know that in TypeScript or ES6, let and const are variables that have block scoping. In JavaScript, there was nothing like block scoping in var variables, normal variables. But here, using let, this let won't be accessible outside the scope of this ng for. In JavaScript, we would have like if else or for loop didn't have its own scoping. If we define anything inside the for loop, it would also available outside that for loop also. Because the scoping of any variable in JavaScript was the function scope, so it would always take that function scope. Now I want to list in every row, I want to iterate. And in Angular 2, all the directives you use have a star written. All the internal directives you use should have a star on the starting. This is just the syntax how they are keeping it. Then you have to write ng4 in camel case. Okay. Then inside the scope, we will have this feedback element. So I will display feedback.name, feedback.company, email. I will have some buttons. Now, the other part. I told you the data binding is done by a one-way unidirectional, by properties from your parent class to your template. And if you want to emit some event from your template to your, you have to use an event method that is called this. Square brackets are for property bindings and the round brackets are for event bindings. Any event you want to bind from your component to your class or code, you have to use this click. Okay? So now I can pass. So this method, whatever expression, this is similar to Angular 1. You have to call a particular method. This method should be present on the scope of this particular component which is rendering this template. Okay. There is no dollar $parent and all, you can't go to parent scope now. If you want to go to some parent, you want to access some data, you have to pass that data as an input. If you want to call some event on the parent, you have to call an event on your scope, and then again you have to call an output event of your parent. We'll see how output event works.
Events,
regular
one events also change like ng click.
Yeah, so ng click is not there now, you don't have to use it. So in Angular 1, they used to have these pseudo directives. So all of these were directives, ng click and all, which were internally calling those click events. Now directly your click events and all will be bound on this property. So there are some basic events that are there, which you can use inside your round and it will trigger that event. These are called event bindings. So these event bindings are available because you are extending your or you are decorating your component with that add component, add the read component. So this is the core feature of an Angular core component. So now I am passing the feedback, this particular feedback object again to my detail row. So this is another row which I will only show if my show row index is coming to this iterator, this index. I wanted to display a list of elements. And I wanted to expand a particular element. So whenever I set the show row index of this particular list component to any particular index, it will get shown. So this whole table row will be shown. Or not even shown, shown is a wrong word. This will be brought into the DOM. So we know ngif is another directive which will, if this expression is false, everything inside or everything in this element is taken out of the DOM. Not even inside the DOM. And whenever this expression evaluates to true, this whole element is brought into the DOM. Okay? So I'll add this to CSS to the list. So why my feedback list is not showing? Because I haven't updated my app component to display the feedback list inside instead of this feedback element. So here I can say I think I missed a step that we have to change the information which we are passing here into an array rather than being a normal that. Let's see if that has been done. So here right now it is just an object, so I have to probably change it to an array, and then in my app component my list was expecting something called list data that was an alias to my local list property of that particular element, and here I can pass this field. Maybe I got some error, let's figure out the error was. So can't bind list data since it's a known property of feedback list. Says it is not a known property of let me just see debug this. So now we have defined this feedback list app. Okay, so I have to change this app to feedback list was not a valid element. I have to change the list again to list data because list isn't a known property. So all the known properties are defined by your input element. List was earlier a known property, but I have alias list. Let's see if it works like this. Yeah. So now it lists, it shows the list, one list. And if I do list data in my app component.html, I have to change this to list data. So you can write an alias to your input property using that add input decorator, passing the string to that. Okay, now it's displaying a list. If I want to create a list of feedback, some data from let's just copy this and then change some data here. And also in my click event, if I go to my list element, feedback.list, I have implemented this function on my class, that is on show button click and row index I'm taking as input, which should be a type of number, and I'm updating the property this.showRowIndex to that row index, and whenever this gets updated, automatically my ngif directly would have triggered and ultimately my element should show. So if I go back, if I click on this show, yeah, so it's showing that particular. So whichever row element I click on, the this.showRowIndex is updated with the row index of that particular row, and my ngif for that particular row gets triggered and it gets shown. Any questions till now? Good enough. So now the next thing is forms and input. How do we create a form? Output of all these tutorial steps, right? I'll probably have to stop this server. Go back to my earlier app, ng-crud app, and then say ng-serve. Mocking server called JSON server, which can mock a JSON file. So whatever that feedback list I had, I have kept it in a mocking file so that I can create a mocking web service. This is the web service, how it looks and it comes. Now the ultimate app which have been made out of my would be like this. We already completed this part. Now coming to the add new part to show a particular form. So I have this form that is being displayed. And whatever I type here, it should be a 10 number. I have added the validation. Okay, so if I don't fill a valid email, it will say not a valid form. I'll show you where the code validity is being done. After I add a valid email, it will validate. If my number is not 10 number, it will say not a valid form. If I add a 10 digit number, it will add to that list. And if I want to see the data which I have added, I can see it like this. Now we'll go to the code, going through the code. Now in that feedback list, we have to add another component called feedback form to display that form on the click of add new button. So how do we write the like form? So there is a great property called form builder, form control and validators from your Angular forms module. So this is a new module in the core of Angular which will enable you to quickly build your forms. So what you can do is your whole form can be formed as a group. So in the constructor of this, you have to inject the form builder. Firstly, you have to include that form builder from here, and then you can inject the instance of form builder into this. Apart from these things, you have to keep in mind that in your app module, you have to keep adding the declarations of any component which you make. Generally, this is automatically done when you do ng-serve or ng-g component. When you create a component, it automatically adds it here. You have to also remember that if you want to use the forms, you have to import the forms module and reactive form module from Angular Forms and then include it here. Okay? And after that, this form I have created, you have to create a structure of this form. This group represents all the properties or all the input elements that will be there in your form. Then you have to assign a particular array. This is the initial values of that array and any kind of validations you want to do. The custom validation of an Indian mobile number 10 digit, there can be a plain function as a validator. You can add a plain function as a validator that will take input and finish it. So here is the plain function that takes a form control, validates and returns if it is value is false or not. And while saving on click of saving, I will get this dot feedback form, the whole feedback element, and it will have properties like if it is valid or not, if there is an error or not. I can check that and do something. This valid can be also there on the control properties. This feedback form will have different controls and you can see which control has error. So you can always drill down to the control which has the validation error. That's it. And how do we integrate to our services? We can create a common service that can integrate to our HTTP APIs. You need the HTTP and response variables from your Angular HTTP, headers, request options, and something called observables. To cut it short for observables, I will not go into detail. It is similar to promise, we'll see. all your functions that want to return some data have to return a type of observable. You can define it will be an array of feedback info, or it will be take input as a feedback only. So what we do is, normally the HTTP module will work like dot get or something. The response of this will be available as a map of object. So map is nothing but the response will be an array. I have to iterate through the response and convert it into JSON and then pass it or return it to whoever is trying to consume it. Maybe after this session we can discuss more about if anyone wants feedback. How to consume it is, in this list, feedback list component, we will see that we have included this feedback service as a provider, and then in the ng on it, I have just called this dot feedback service dot get feedbacks instead of dot then, which we do in terms of promises. We have to do dot subscribe when we want to listen the response of an observable, and then we listen to this like this. So this is all about what we had to achieve. But to cut short time, I just told you about this. You can go on to that link and follow the steps. If anything is missing, please email me. I'll add to that particular URL. Surely I'll add the CSS before going today. Okay. Just for 5 more minutes, I'll be talking about the migration strategies. If in your particular companies, if you want to migrate your so Vinci, probably you can also come and join in and so migrating from Angular 1 to Angular 2, you would think that there was some magic hat and you would just pass the Angular 1 and Angular 2 should come. Everyone is expecting this. Why it is a problem? We should have something like a converter. You pass in your Angular 1 app and Angular 2 app should come in. But because of the re-architecture of that is not possible. Our V1 apps are something like this. They are not performant enough. And if you want something like a shiny car, we have to do a lot of efforts. Without a lot of efforts, there is no out of the box magic migration for Angular 1 apps. That is just, you have to forget. So, and also one more important thing I want to tell everyone, that do not migrate to learn. If you want to learn Angular 2, just don't start with the migration. You would go into a bad path and you would say that I don't want to learn Angular 2 and don't want to use Angular 2 and migrate to some other. So learn, build some hobby projects in Angular 2 first and then try on your hands on migration. So there are three strategies on migration. One is a total conversion. So if your app is a very tiny project, you should probably do a total conversion and create a new app and code by code, just take your JavaScript logic into that new constructs. The new constructs of components and all, you should just take those structure there and put it there. But the problem is there is no incremental validation. You will not be able to tell that you are doing right or not. You have to just evaluate manually yourself. It is similar to a complete rewrite of your application. It is a good opportunity to improve your application. It will be tough for complex app. If you have a large app, I would not suggest this method. But this method will give you the best performances of the new framework, right? So there are some examples how earlier we used to do bootstrapping like angular.bootstrap. Now in V2 we do bootstrapping like now in Angular 2 we do bootstrapping like we have seen this whole complex stuff. In controllers, in V0 there was controllers. Then Angular told that controllers should be written as this. If you remember controller as syntax, controller as syntax is similar to using constructor and this and dollar all in it, and it is more like your Angular 2 apps. So firstly I would suggest that convert your Angular 1 apps basic controllers into controller as syntax and using this angular.1.5+ components. Then this is the new components V2 we have already seen. This is how modules were in V1 angular.module. And this is how the modules are in V2 with imports, bootstraps and declarations. your router in V1 is like user state going into your route provider or state provider. In V2, your routes are nothing but every path is corresponding to a component. So I told you your router is nothing but a component driven router. Then the second strategy. If you don't want to do a total conversion, you have to do an ng forward or ng metadata. So this is an open source project which was created by someone with suitable for legacy projects. What happened is, in this strategy, your Angular 1 app and Angular 2 apps could coexist, and you could only upgrade one by one file and keep on working on that. But this was an open source project by some third party. Similar to this, there was another thing called ng upgrade. This particular library has been supported and backed by Google Core Angular team. So this is the best way to go forward for you. It has, it is also running Angular 1 and Angular 2 simultaneously. Angular 1 is at core and then everything else is inside. The steps would be set up webpack and all. I'll share this probably service. So what is the path? You can upgrade controllers directive services. Your controllers will get upgraded to components. Directives will get upgraded to your components. Services will get upgraded to Angular 2 services. What you cannot upgrade is your structure and directives, because there is something different in Angular 2. You have to rewrite. So these things you have to rewrite in a different manner. Filters also you have to rewrite. This upgrade will be possible using this ng upgrade module. Probably Vinci will talk something about ng upgrade.
Sure.
So I'm done with the thing. So thanks guys. I'll share this PPT which has some important links for that.
Okay, so this upgrade thing is a very interesting space. It's also been a challenge for a lot of people. How many of you guys have had problems or the challenge of trying to migration? Had any success with that? Have anybody tried working on that? Okay. So while ng upgrade exists as a component that you can use, I think there are certain guidelines and restrictions in terms of how you can use ng upgrade. And one of the fundamental benefits of an ng upgrade is you can have an Angular 1 component and an Angular 2 component coexist on a single page. So that's one of the benefits of that. But for that to work, you obviously need to be on an Angular 1.5x version. You cannot be on a lower version than that. And you need to follow the component-based architecture. It's only then that ng upgrade works very well. And what you're seeing practically is that not every project is on 1.5. And many times, if a project is on 1.5, they don't really want to move to Angular 2, right? Because they just built the entire thing. It's working pretty well. Most of the challenges that we usually face are where projects are on a legacy version, so 1.2 or 1.3. That's when your digest cycles are hitting, your performance problems are hitting you, and you're trying to migrate that to an ng2. And that's where ng upgrade does not really work in. And you need to figure out some other strategies or some other ways you can do that. And this is actually an open discussion. In fact, I was hoping to get feedback from you all in terms of, you know, have you guys tried it? What are the challenges you guys have faced? And maybe if you've got an ng1 app, the hackathon will try and figure out ways of how you can migrate it to an ng2 app. A couple of ideas have been thrown around the board. There's one thing called ng migrate, which is from the Telerik guys. So they have a certain set of guidelines and principles on how you can migrate. Some other things that we are trying to advocate is, so okay, fine, you may not be able to do a component level migration, but can you look at doing a module level migration or a page level migration? So say you have got, say for example, you have an e-commerce site, right? You have a home page, product listing page, a product details page. Your home page may be Angular 1. The moment you click on that link and you go to the listing page, maybe that is an Angular 2 page. So that entire page is made in Angular 2. That goes to Angular 2 library. The first one goes to Angular 1 library. That would be a performance impact, but then that's only during the phase when you are migrating. Right? So some of these strategies are there. So if you're doing a page level migration, then what are the things that you need to take into account? So some of the things that come to the top of the mind for me are routing. How do you route? How do you manage routing between an Angular 1 and an Angular 2? You might need to hard code certain things. That works. The second thing comes to session management. How do you do session management? Suppose I'm on the Angular 1 side of the app, I added a couple of items to cart. So when I go to the Angular 2 app, then when I go there, I should still get to see my cart items, right? Or I should still be logged in. So how do you handle those kind of scenarios? And I think those are open questions to discuss. But going forward, I think there's going to be a pretty serious problem. I would say interesting and challenging problem to solve, because every case is going to be unique. you cannot have this one framework or one boilerplate saying, hey, this is this magic mat, like how Rajan is saying, there's no way you can do that. You know, you'll have to figure out one-on-one cases and how you can migrate, but you can have a strategy in place saying, okay, this is how you can manage routing, or these are the five or six things that you need to worry about. So if you have this checklist in place, you can start working on that. It's an open discussion. I mean, there's no hard and fast.
And I guess most of us know that these days, a lot of we were discussing yesterday also, a lot of fintech companies have moved to, towards Angular JS type, and they have implemented such large projects in Angular JS that this can be a market in whole, that upgradation.
That would be a huge business, not a service line to do that. Yes. So a lot of fintech, especially, so you know, companies like Capital One, I've got Fidelity, we have got
Morgan Stanley,
the Hartford, even Mastercard, so they're all on Angular. Whatever reason, I mean, they're chosen Angular stack, they're all on, and they kind of sort of stuck on it saying, how do we migrate? And they're huge legacy applications where you cannot do a big bang migration saying, you know, you're running on Angular 1 and suddenly one finding you're on Angular 2 and everything just works perfectly. No business is going to be ready for that. You want a gradual migration. So how do we try and get that is what the question is.
Actually, Ng Upgrade provides, I mean, I'm talking about that C Sharp and DB.NET. There is some convert. There are implemented, and it pretty much gives the similar code. So here, right now, we don't have anything, you know, that, yes, we, like, Angular 2, we need some components, and Angular 1X has some controllers. So if you put something here, this said it comes with components or something. Not as, so Ng Upgrade is the solution to that. What Ng Upgrade does is,
it allows you to upgrade a component or downgrade a component. So even there, you can have a strategy where saying, I have an NG one component, I kind of move it into an NG two mode or an NG two downgrade that. So there are strategies for that. The challenge to that is that code has to be written in the right way. What we have seen practically is that people have written Angular code the way they want. Root scopes, controllers, jQueries inside. I mean, it's an amazing word inside Angular code. So the challenge is there because it's not very structured in every,
We have a project, we are working with Angular 1, almost we have completed.
Right.
We have around 600 forms, which is a huge. So we have around, for one product, we have different verticals, like with the same sets of, like three modules are there, we can just take the same and plug into the other one. So planning to go for the other migration now. So we are going to migrate with that two. So suppose the common components, what we have, like security modules, or we can say admin modules. So that I can take from the Angular 1 and then the top of that I can build with Angular 2. Both will work together.
So what will you see? So are you referring to services?
No, I'm not.
The whole Ng Upgrade is a project which will enable you to run Angular 1 and Angular 2 code bases simultaneously. But you have to do some manual efforts in there. That you have to like make your Angular 1 code such that it is upgradable by this Ng Upgrade module. So you have to write proper the way I wrote. Your controller should have controller as syntax. You should have this scoping properly. You should have lifecycle events and like that.
So if I don't want to migrate, I will keep it as it is like in Angular 1. It will not just another what I'm going to develop. Top of that, I will have to put Angular 1 also.
You can do that, but the question is, do we have to migrate? So when a user, when I'm navigating through application, am I going to jump from an Angular 2 to an Angular 1, or are they going to be just siloed?
Yeah, it will be, Angular 1 will be there, and top of that,
this Ng Upgrade thing, it doesn't let you have an Angular 2 app on top. So all of these migration has run inside an Angular 1 app. So Angular 1 app is your core app, and inside you, some parts you can run your Angular 2 code. That is the problem.
So the strategy with Ng Upgrade is you have an Angular 1 app. You decide what components you want to convert to Angular 2. So at a component level, you start migrating them. And as you're migrating them, during runtime, you're still kind of degrading into an Ng 1 experience. But your code is Angular 2, which means over a period of time, all your components become an Angular 2 code, and this will switch over to Angular 2. So that's the way they are building it.
And this is an interesting use case, having 600 forms in an application. And my personal opinion, yesterday also discussed. We all front-end developers should understand that if you have a single-page app, it is not fair because we can create 600 or 700 views in one app. If you have a website, if you see a traditional website, each website, if it had one function, if one section had one function, it would have different server-side routes. So generally what we suggest is that if you have a large web application, you should always have micro single-page apps depending on different route sections, that would render your different apps. This is the best architecture or the best structure you could follow for your large apps, complex app. Have siloed micro apps rendering on different server-side routes.
But it is a shipping product. It has to be have that much number of platforms.
No, so the number of what is trying to say?
It's just a ERP product. It's
not I am saying that, but divide your 600 forms into say logical units of like 450.
So I'm probably assuming it's going to be a collection of small apps.
Yeah,
okay. Having a collection of small apps helps because you
no, but ultimately your 600 forms are in one Angular app, right?
Yeah, it is a shipping product. Okay, in the shipping product, it is just a one product. It's required this number of components.
So these days, if you see that if you want to ship a web app, you can ship it as a native app like using Electron. So Electron provides you a server, node server inbuilt, and you could have different routes rendering your different micro. There are different applications.
We have different routes for each one, but based on the menu and all, we'll be picking some.
I'll probably discuss this.
You can take it offline. So that will be interesting. Okay. Any questions anybody has got, we can break and then we can turn that side.